Hey, Daniel Platt here. Have you ever tried to remember a website that you've been to? You know you've been to it, but maybe it was a little while ago. Maybe it was a year ago. Maybe you know something about the domain name, what's in it, what words, but you can't quite put your finger on what it was. And probably not the starting letter, otherwise Safari would make that a bit easier with auto-suggest. So, we've got history in Safari, and it's very good if you know when it was. I wanted to look at all the domain names and try to see if I recognised it. In Safari, that would have taken a long time. That makes it a bit more tricky, because if the website I went to was a year ago, I don't want to click on all and then start looking through absolutely everything I did, because I'll be here all day, and I'm not guaranteed to even find it then. So there's got to be a better way. And there is. But it does involve delving into the terminal. So here we go. Now Safari has a special folder, and it's inside your user library. But unfortunately, I haven't figured out a way to get Terminal to show the contents or interact with the contents. So the easiest way to do it is actually to do it in Finder. And that'll open up a window. And the file we're looking for is called history.db. Don't be fooled by any of the other files, the log file. It's this one we want. And the easiest way to deal with it is if we duplicate it and copy it to our desktop. So, here's my history file, it's on the desktop. If you put it on your desktop, then we'll know where it is. And I'm going to assume that it is on your desktop from now on. So if we change into our desktop. Now what is this file? This file is an SQLite file. So we can't just open it with a text browser or a text editor and just do that. We need to use a special program. Now, I'm fairly sure it comes with Catalina, and it's called SQLite 3. But if you have any problems, it will probably also come with the Xcode install, or the command line install tools. And how we deal with it, or how we open it, is we type SQLite 3 and then the file name like this and then hit enter, and then we've loaded the file. But how do we know what's inside it? Well, there's a couple of SQLite commands, and one of them's called tables, and that shows you what's in there, which is brilliant. And the one we're interested in is called history_items. But what's in history items? We've got two ways we can find out. There's another command called schema. And if we type that in, we'll get this blob of data. This tells us how SQLite created it, or this table. And if we format it correctly, well, a new line after every comma, then we will end up with something like this, which looks pretty interesting. We've got URL, we've got some counts, and we've got a score. Okay, let's get some data. We can type it's almost like regular SQL. Select star from history items, and I can put a limit one, not forgetting the semicolon. So the first line in there is Bootstrap, which is fairly safe because I go there a lot. Okay, what can we do to get this to be a little bit more helpful? We can, if we quit out of SQLite, what we can do is we can capture all that data into a CSV file and then open it up in, say, Numbers or Excel. So let's do that now. So we need the same command we had. We want the headers, because otherwise we won't know which column's which. We want to tell it's a CSV, because with those pipe symbols, that's not native to the CSV format. And then we can pass it the same command we just typed. Obviously without the limit one, because we want the whole document. And then we use the greater than symbol to say, take the contents and put it into a file. And we do that. And we run it, it takes a few seconds. Well, it could take longer depending on how fast your computer is and how much history there is. So we can see there, it's actually about 8 megabytes of data, which is not too bad. So if I open that up in Excel, then we've got the header, which makes it easier. We've got the URL. We've got the ID that Safari uses internally, which is okay. I don't think it's going to be useful for us unless there's something in other tables that maybe link off it. Domain expansion. I suspect that's something that helps Safari figure out when you're auto-completing which page you're most likely to want. Visit count, how often you've been there. No idea over what time span that is. But considering over 2,000 for Google Mail, and Google Mail's in there multiple times, it's probably a fair amount. Our visitor counts are going to be encoded in some way. I've no idea. Same for autocomplete triggers. I'm not too fussed about that. Recompute derived visit count. Don't know. And we've got a visit count score. Again, no idea what that is. But what I really am interested in is this URL. And then we can basically just say, find inside the program, inside Excel, inside Numbers, for whatever we want. And it will, and this will help you if you can find something, some word that was in the domain name that you were searching for, then it'll make it very easy. So in the case of Bootstrap, if you couldn't remember get or boot, then you could just type strap and it will find it for you. Whereas Safari typing strap in would be very unlikely to find what you're looking for. Hope this helps. I'll see you in another video. Goodbye.